welcome to this week's episode of Two Guys and Some Horror. In this week's episode, we're talking about 1980s John Carpenter film, The Fog. So this will be the kickoff to our John Carpenter month. Next week, we have another great episode that we've actually already recorded, but don't worry about the man behind the curtain here. This film was written by John Carpenter and Deborah Hill, who also helped write Halloween. The budget for this was only $1 million, and the body count was six.
Six. Also, Jamie Lee Curtis and her mother
star in this film. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, hello, how are you? How you doing, Clark?
Doing wonderful, man. It's good to be here. It's always good to be here. How about yourself, Curtis?
I'm doing good. Today was a work-from-home day, so we're trying out a new setup today. We got two mics, not one, two mics. Normally, we're just recording on my one mic, but today we're trying out something a little different, so we'll see how it goes. I'm excited.
We got a little distance between us.
There's a large space between us.
We could both be eating a pizza right now if we really wanted to.
Our own pizzas.
Yeah, exactly. It's
perfect. In honor of Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles.
Oh, great, yeah. Wonderful. What about Ninja Turtles?
It's like their anniversary, 25th anniversary. Oh, really? Of the original film. Yeah.
Eastman and Laird. Oh, yeah.
It's on Netflix. Check it out.
Oh, really? I'm in.
All right, so let's go ahead and move on to Clark's quick review.
Yarr. It be true, this movie be about pirates. It be basically Christine, or Maximum Overdrive, where a fog takes over shit and turns it alive. But not really, and pirates be killing all the people in the village for no real reason except for gold. Yarr. This is an okay movie. This is one of those movies that you watch and then you're like, ah, and then you forget about it.
I would agree. I agree completely. Also, great job on your quick review. Love it. Keep them coming. But yeah, let's go ahead and get into the synopsis and the discussion of this movie. It shouldn't take very long because it's really not that much to it. It's a good movie, not a great movie, like we said, but it is a John Carpenter film, so right. There are some really nice aspects to it.
It starts off very, very slow, and I feel that that is a major drawback of this film, is it does a good job of building up the tension, but it doesn't really feel like there's any repercussions to it. It's just kind of like, oh, people died, and it happened, and I don't know. At the very beginning, we get to hear Stevie, who has a very sexy and sultry voice.
Are you skipping Grandpa?
Oh, no, I would never skip Grandpa.
So we get the exposition about... Alamo Bay, Antonio Bay,
from the priest.
From Grandpa the Campfire with Andrew the kid.
Oh right.
So he's telling the campfire story. Which, by the way, this soundtrack, if you like John Carpenter, this is a really good soundtrack because that's how the soundtrack starts as well. Basically it's 12 o'clock and he's telling this campfire story about the ghost. So he gives a really good exposition about the founders of said town, and you know, it just really sets the mood. I think it's first of all, it's super slow. It's very slow paced. So is this exposition, and so we'll fast forward through it that way you guys don't have to suffer with us. But
you don't want to talk about the campfire story. Well, it moves to Father Malone right after,
and it then does. Yeah,
Father Malone, who is an alcoholic priest, he finds the diary of his grandfather.
He does. A rock falls out of the wall. A stone falls out of the wall, and I think. Because this is the 100th anniversary of Antonio Bay, and this is like the ghosts, you know, starting to move in. That was the beginning, rock falling and him finding the diary.
They're about to have like a giant party.
Celebration of some sort.
Yeah, perfect. And then he sees that in the diary at some point, it says like six of the founders, including his grandfather, the priest's grandfathers, they deliberately sank a ship that was owned by some wealthy man with leprosy. And the six conspirators kind of lit the ship on fire.
Basically, yeah. It's basically the lepers were asking... They would give them gold, right? In order to live just a couple hundred miles north of where Antonio Bay was. And they would never bother Antonio Bay. And the father, back in the day, his great-grandfather, Father Malone, whatever... decided that it would be okay, they'd figure it out, but it was the other founding fathers that started to create that mutiny, basically, against...
But all six of them
burnt down the ship.
They all like, basically are, yeah, you're guilty by association.
They stole their gold.
Yeah.
They stole the leper pirate's gold, because they're pirates now. They want their gold back.
They're ghost pirates.
At the very beginning, like the fog kind of slowly goes in and it kills people.
Yeah. I mean, it's, so, you're talking about the seagrass?
Well, we see the guy, he's in the shop, like, right after Father Malone, and he's failing to use a push broom correctly. Mm-hmm. Yeah, no offense.
Just that kid has no idea how to use a push broom. And he also drinks out of the orange juice and then puts it back in the thing. Like, that's so gross.
Yeah, this is a store, by the way. The FDA would not approve.
No. No. What the hell's wrong with you? Don't touch the orange juice, man. I drink that shit. Anyways, so he doesn't know how to use a push broom. He's drinking out of cups, being a bitch. And then we move on to, does the fog roll in there and do, it doesn't do any harm to him though.
I don't think anybody dies until the fisherman.
Yeah. Till the seagrass.
Right. Yep.
So let's, are we there yet? I think we might be there yet. No.
We're close.
We're close. 6 minutes after midnight, all the cars in the town. This is what you were talking about with the Christine / Maximum Overdrive kind of moment where all the cars decide to lose their shit at the same time.
Well, and also the gas pumps, everything's kind of going off. It's like inanimate objects are kind of being moved around on their own. It was a bit spoopy. Do spoopify me.
Ooh, spoopy. So we get then we have Jamie Lee Curtis hopping in a car with Tom Atkins.
Right.
And she gets in the car, in the truck with him. Then she decides to ask, are you weird?
And he's like, yeah.
Yeah, totally weird.
Oh, thank God. Oh,
thank God, because the last guy who picked me up was totally normal, and it just drove me nuts. By the time we got to the town, he was in love with me. Yeah, it was a weird conversation.
Even though the two of them hit it off directly, man. After and decide. Tom Atkins always tends to hoink the boink in all of his horror movies. I don't understand why. He's not the most attractive man in the world, but
he was your typical perfect person to cast, I guess, in that time, late 70s, early 80s, as a Don Juan, but I don't get it. I don't see it.
And he had the charisma. I understand him as a
charisma,
doctor.
Yes,
but not so much in this movie. I don't even remember. I think it was like he did stuff with boats. It wasn't.
No, he was a fisherman, yeah.
Yeah, it wasn't very interesting.
Lucrative fisherman.
Very lucrative.
So let's get back to Dan the weatherman, because this is your favorite part.
Well, they're driving, blown out. Like, that's important. And chairs start to move, TVs turn on, and, you know, after they arrive at, like, the coastal house, but, you know, you're talking about the fishermen, like, they get killed by supernatural attackers when the fog kind of covers. And you see the shadows in the fog, but we don't really get a close eye on what kills them.
You really don't get a good look at these ghost pirates, I'd say, until the end of the movie.
Even then.
Like, you get, his name is?
You see one, but
that's the only one you see.
It's not even a good shot of what they look like. It's just a shadow.
That's fair, yeah. Yes. Blake is the only one you see, and you barely see. I mean, you get a good look at his face, I guess. They have really cool makeup on the eyes.
Right.
But that's about it, yeah.
No, I like the eyes looked good. Good effects. Yeah, too spoopy. But Nick, who is Tom Atkins' character, he and Elizabeth, who is the character of Jamie Lee Curtis, they arrive at the home. They're doing some heavy
coitus.
Yes, that stuff.
They get to fucking.
Whoa.
That's a hat tip to Horror Movie Night, another podcast that I enjoy.
Oh, nice.
One of the characters, whenever he mentions sex, he says, get to fucking.
I love it. But they hear a knock on the door, and they see, like, a shadowy figure. The clock strikes 1 a.m., and the clock cracks right as Nick opens the door. And there's nobody there, and the fog just kind of goes away.
Do you think that's daybreak, 1 a.m.? I mean, honestly, sunrise isn't until what? 4 o'clock usually, earliest.
Honestly, I think this is before it's the time where they're able to even do anything with their full abilities whatever.
They killed the guys on the boat.
Yeah, but they were on the boat and the fog was starting to roll into the town.
Oh, fair enough. Yeah, it didn't have enough time to like get in.
I would assume it had to roll back in because the following day, the kid finds like a golden doubloon and it turns into wood.
Mm-hmm. Driftwood.
Like, wood that just says Dane.
Yes. I wrote that down because I knew it had something to do with the story and I wanted to make sure I didn't screw that up.
Right. Dane.
Dane. So Elizabeth Dane is the name of the boat.
Right.
Right. We learn that later on.
Mm-hmm.
Jimmy Lee Curtis's character's name is Elizabeth.
Mm-hmm.
But we don't ever find her last name.
Nope.
But she then goes, and I know I'm fast forwarding really hard here, but we'll come back. Yeah, we'll come back. But she goes on later because you mentioned the clock.
Half her kill count.
You mentioned the exploding windows in the truck, the clock, all the horrible things that are happening in town. She basically tells Nick Castle, like, hey, this is my fault ever since I've been here.
Weird things happen.
Weird things have been happening. Yeah. And I'm like, so I start to think, what if Elizabeth is actually connected to Elizabeth Dane somehow, the boat?
What if Elizabeth is Laurie Strode?
And then Michael shows up.
Oh.
And the babysitter gets killed. Ooh.
No babysitters this time.
There was.
Oh.
Andrew has the babysitter, Beatrice.
That's right.
Or whatever her name is. Anyways, we're going to go right back to where we were. Okay, so I want to hear more about your love for Stevie.
For Stevie? Oh, Stevie's got a great voice, but... The one thing I don't like is Dan the weatherman, who keeps, you know, he keeps making passes at her, and they're very obvious, and she's very much deflecting them. And he's like, "You coming to the party tonight? When do I get to see you next?"
And every time he's talking to her, he's calling her sweetheart.
Yeah,
I mean, this is a total late '70s, early '80s. Like, guys thought that was totally normal and okay, and it's just. I mean, nowadays...
She's single, he's single, he wants to mingle, she might not, and who cares what she thinks? You gotta keep pursuing what you want, and maybe someday you'll get it, and a lot of guys do that, and sometimes it works out, most of the time it doesn't. Sometimes people wear each other down, but I don't know.
No means no.
Yeah.
She didn't say no, I guess.
To be fair, he never was forceful, he was just creepy, and...
I love Dan the weatherman, creepy. That's probably the best way to do it.
Well, Stevie's on her set. She owns a lighthouse, which is also her radio station.
Mm-hmm.
And she's doing a show, and then Blake, who was the leader of the lepers, or the pirate captain, as I would like to say.
Arr.
Yeah. It reads like the piece of driftwood that she got says 6 must die. And then it bursts into flames.
You're talking about when it, like, possessed the tape?
Yeah.
So that's a really neat scene. I looked up the effect on how they did the water through the driftwood. They basically hooked up... So when it's sitting there, it just says Dane, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then they hooked up some small, like, tubing to the back of it in, like, 3 spots. Flooded water up through it, which pushed through the driftwood out, trickled down... The water then, you know, got down into the tape player, which is what's running the recording. It's like her pre-show recording. It basically just keeps repeating itself.
Right.
But as the water hits that, then they did their effect where they possessed, the ghost possessed the tape recorder and said, 6 must die, right?
Yeah.
Then the shit burst on fire or into flames. And yeah, that's the scene, basically.
Well, Stevie extinguishes it immediately.
Yep.
And then, like, the plank... It says, again, Dane.
Yep.
Which, you know, that throws her off. She's a little shaken. And I think
she's shook.
At some point, she connects to Dan, or Mr. Atkins' character, Nick. I don't remember exactly where, but the Nick and Elizabeth, they go on the seagrass.
Well, he calls into the radio station.
Yeah.
Because he's... I mean, that's how they initially connect, but he's there to pick up his stuff at the dock from the gentleman who went out on the seagrass. So that's basically the storyline there. That's how they get kind of roped in this whole thing. He's on his way to pick up a delivery from his fisherman friends, and then he's like, no, there's no way. It doesn't matter how drunk we got. We always came back or let them know we weren't coming back tonight. And his buddies basically don't show up, and that's because all 3 of them are still on the seagrass out in the middle of the ocean. They got whacked by these ghost pirates, right? So where we're at right now, in the movie at least, is Tom Atkins' character and Jamie Lee Curtis, they're heading out now because a guy owes Tom a favor. So they're heading out to go find the seagrass.
Yeah, so Nick Tom's character.
Nick Castle. Yeah. Yep.
They go to this boat and they find one of the fishermen. I think they find one body and he has no eyes.
Yeah.
So they take him to the coroner and the coroner is like, I need to pull you aside, Nick. And they have a conversation. They leave Elizabeth alone in the room of the corpse. And yep. The corpse reanimates, gets up. He's back and he's about to stab her.
Or you
slice
think.
Slice. You think so. And then he plops down and on the floor you see the number 3 scratched on.
So as a listener, you should know right now, we've already mentioned, this is just us kind of helping everyone paint the picture. 6 must die. He scribbled 3 into the ground. And that either means he's killed 3 or 3 are left. Doesn't really matter. They gave you a pretty good, you know, answer. Basically, 3. So we know at this point that 3 are left, however they want to do it or whatever. And from here, I mean, there's so much, like...
exposition, pretty much.
Basically, yeah.
Is she the mayor or what? What? Whoever...
She is... First of all, she's the guy who went out on the seagrass. That's his wife. But she's also either the mayor or, like, a councilman of some type. Councilwoman.
Yeah.
For the town. And she's an important figurehead of some sort.
She's leading the celebration, and she has her assistant who's like, yes, Sandy. Ma'am. Yes, ma'am. And she's like, you're the only person who can make yes, ma'am sound awful or something along those lines.
You're the only person who can make yes, ma'am sound like go fuck yourself or something like that.
And then she says, yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. After that. So she's Annie from Halloween. Hmm. Another callback character that John Carpenter was in love with.
John Carpenter loves reusing actors that he, you know, he has a good connection with.
Yeah, Tom Atkins. Annie's character, Jamie Lee Curtis.
Also Kurt Russell.
Kurt Russell's a huge one.
Yeah, I would say Annie would have been another. Just and he usually puts himself in his movies. I don't know if he did in this one or not. I haven't looked in the trivia, but he put himself.
Oh,
in
damn! Yeah, you're right. I didn't look.
He was a corpse in the thing. So
yeah,
who knows?
Annie is Tom Atkins' wife, if you remember in Halloween 3.
That's right.
Yeah. So like she's been in all 3 of these movies that we've discussed on the podcast so far. She can't be in the thing because it's all dudes, but that's a whole nother story for another week.
Well, there was a female voice in the thing.
But it's his wife.
Yes, it was John Carpenter's wife.
At the time, yeah.
Yes, at the time. Well, anyhow.
I'm not so sure I want you. You're just a voice on the phone.
Stevie's left her her son, I think at this point, with the babysitter, Beatrice.
Yes.
She's at the lighthouse alone. Dan, the weatherman, calls her. He's got a knock at the door, and she's like, don't open the door. Don't open the door. Don't open the door. Dan opens the door.
And so you just blew right through the quote.
What was
I gave it to you. You were leading up to it beautifully, and then we just missed it. I was hoping you had that one written down.
I ruined it.
No, you didn't ruin it. You're good. So basically, they're flirting on the phone still. And this is where Stevie shows a little bit of flirting back, I'd say. The most minuscule, but
if flirting in a way of "Hey, leave me alone,"
maybe
she relies on him for her work. Like I wouldn't, to me, in my perspective, like if I were her, I'd be doing the same thing. Just I don't want this guy to get angry at me because he's a coworker,
sure.
But I don't want anything to do with him beyond professionalism, like beyond a professional setting.
Right,
and that's fair.
So basically, she's like, "I'm not so sure I want you. You're just a voice on the phone."
Right.
And then he says, and you're just a voice in the radio. We'd make a perfect couple. Mm. So that's where he is definitely like laying it out there. He's flirting with her. He's letting her know he's flirting with her more than just a friend.
Well, but everybody's after her. Like there are other characters earlier on in the movie. The fishermen are talking about her, like how attracted they are to her. And
if she wasn't so married to her work, she probably would have met someone in that town that she found attractive.
She has her son. Like, I think she's
no,
doing
she's
fine.
Super busy.
She's a strong, independent woman. She don't need no man.
Agreed. She's very busy.
And, you know, who are we to judge who she's attracted to in the first place?
We don't even know who she's attracted
to. We don't,
to.
Exactly. So, anyhow, Dan opens the door.
Dumb decision.
And he gets hooked in the throat.
Which is a pretty good kill.
Right.
He's number 4.
So it's like a hook or like one of those scythe hooks.
Mm-hmm. Like an ice block hook or a fisherman's hook type thing.
Yeah.
I know what you did last summer. That's the, right. the kill. What is it? The kill weapon.
Right.
Yep. So let's see. I mean, the main point here that we're working through is that the town is still planning on throwing this big party.
Mm-hmm.
They're not. So far, not everyone's really aware that people are going missing and that people are being killed.
Well, it's four people so far. And phone lines are getting cut. Power's getting cut.
All done by the fog.
Stevie's, like, going crazy at this point on her radio station. She's like, don't go in the fog. Don't let it in.
Yep. She's like, basically telling her son and the babysitter to get the hell out of that house and to run. She's basically yelling over the radio line.
Head north. Like if you were.
She starts to guide him. Yep.
She's going, don't head south. Head north. The fog is coming in. Stay away from it. And it's like glowing. It's like a magical glowing fog. But anyhow, the babysitter, she's an older lady. She hears a knock at the door. She tells Annie, she's like, go to your room, young man, and I'll give you a butterscotch. And she goes to the door and kill number five. Right there. Dies, she gets impaled. I wanna say it was like a pipe? I can't really see these kills very well in this film.
Yeah, no, they're not really on screen, to be fair. A lot of these kills are like a sudden movement, a jump scare. And then it cuts away and moves on in the story. These aren't super extravagant gore fest kills. So if you're into gore, it's not going to be a big thing for you. If you don't like gore and you still like suspense and jump scares, this is perfect for you.
Right. And so like, going back, I don't remember who. I remember the mayor or the councilwoman, whoever she is, Jamie Lee Curtis's mother, the actress, whoever her character is. She hears the radio station at some point. And she's like, mm-hmm. What's this?
Yeah, so they're basically driving. Okay, so they go to get you caught up.
Right.
Tom Atkins, so Nick Castle and Elizabeth save Andy in the truck.
Well, before that even, like.
Well, they hear the radio when they're on their way to the, on their way home from the celebration.
Right.
So she's stressed and worried that her husband's not coming home. They get in the car. Sandy tells her we need to go home. And she once again makes kind of that comment like, you know what? You can be a real bitch sometimes, but you're right. I need to go home.
Even before that, like they get stuck in a pothole in their truck.
When they're rescuing Andrew,
the boy. Yeah, they have to drive in reverse.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. So just to get out. So they save Andy, they get out, and they head to the church. Mm-hmm. We have all the characters who've been introduced to us so far all meet at the church. We have
except for Stevie. She's stuck at the DJ booth.
That's right. Stevie's there the whole time.
She's an independent woman. She doesn't need anyone.
She's the voice. She's the very uppity person in the theater who yells at the screen saying, oh, don't go that way.
She really is.
Yeah, yeah, no.
Because
no.
She's guiding them through the town as the fog is cutting off different areas of the streets, which is really cool. It's actually a really nice way of, I guess, doing it. Because normally, you know, you don't have that kind of all-seeing, all-knowing, omnipresent kind of figure helping you get to a safe place. And she does. She guides them to the church, and they get there safely. But now, like you're saying, all the characters who have come into contact with the ghosts or anything to do with the ghosts are all there. So you've got...
We have the Kathy, who is Jamie Lee Curtis's mother, the actress. Kathy, we have her assistant, we have Andy, we have Nick, we have Elizabeth, and we have Father Malone.
Yep.
And I think there might be one other person? I'm not sure. I don't remember.
I don't think so. I think you're right.
At this point, the fog's kind of rolling in, and Father Malone, he confronts Blake's ghost, and he throws a cross down. He's like, here's your gold. The ghosts disappear.
Did you notice when the ghost started attacking the church? Like, that first hand that comes through the window and grabs Sandy or whatever? Like, Father Malone doesn't even flinch. He is, like, so drunk or... I don't know, his character knew it was going to happen or whatever, that he doesn't even move. There is no reaction. Everybody else in that room, like, freaks out, but he's just, like, stoic. Yep, that happened.
I think he is drunk, because they show him drinking quite a bit. But as far as the reaction go, they probably have something.
Should have had something.
A little delayed. It was, you're right, that not the best acting on his part, but you know, it's
but they're all battling the ghost pirates at this point, trying not to be the sixth victim. Because Father Malone once again gives us more exposition as they went in with the book again, explaining that, you know, they're going to come back for the gold now. This is basically let them know. So these ghost pirates are all like trying to get to them and everything. Like you said, they end up breaking into the main auditorium area seating. And Blake, that's when Blake walks up to Father Malone, because Father Malone grabbed the golden cross and then walked out to them.
He gave it to them.
He basically handed it to Blake. And then this like beam of light and fog begins to consume the three entities. Blake, the Golden Cross, and the Reverend.
Well, Nick pulls Father Malone away.
Yep, which breaks the connection.
So everybody leaves at some point. Everybody's safe after this. Like, the ghosts take it. They're gone. It's like the fog's gone, too. And it's like,
it's almost roll credits time.
Yeah,
feel like this is the end of the movie.
Yeah. And then afterwards, you see Father Malone, he's in a room, and he's like, why not me, Blake? When then you see the first close-up of a ghost, there's no fog around him, and the ghost slices off Father Malone's head, and then the credits roll.
Yeah, it was great. I mean, that ending was really good. I think it had a really nice twist.
He did a good job with this movie. I don't know why it's so not memorable.
Because it's slow, man. Like, the pacing is just god-awful slow. The acting is nothing special. No. We've seen Tom Atkins act way better than this. We've seen Jamie Lee Curtis act better than this. I mean, those are your two main characters, really. Stevie did a phenomenal job. She, hands down, best actress in this movie.
Mm-hmm. And best character.
Yes, best character as well.
Second would be Kathy's assistant.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes,
we didn't get enough of her assistant.
We really didn't, and we don't get enough of more of the town, I would say. Like, you only get really that one gathering at the town for the celebration, and you really get no other attachment to this town. You could give two shits about this town.
They remade this movie in 2005. So when this movie came out, by the way, I think it grossed like about $21 million. I think we talked about this earlier. That's off the top of my head. We can fact check that later, but
please don't fact check us.
Essentially, this movie did really well despite it being kind of panned by the critics, and it wasn't like it did pretty well for a horror movie back in the 80s, like back when horror movies were a little bit a bigger thing than they are now. But they remade it in 2005, and it's terrible.
Agreed. Yeah,
it's so bad.
There's very few remakes that are actually good in our day and age that are, you know, remakes. For instance, The Thing got remade. It was terrible.
What about the Halloween remake? Because that's the Rob Zombie one. I haven't seen it yet.
So we'll get there, I think, one day. It's got to be on the list because we have to talk about the pros and cons of that film.
Well, he also remade Friday the 13th, I think.
No, not yet. No. Friday the 13th wasn't done by Rob Zombie. It was done by someone else, but it was a full-on remake of it. But it wasn't... So here's the deal with remakes nowadays. You've got, like, true blue remakes, like the Fog one, which was a literal almost shot-for-shot trying to remake the movie.
Also Nightmare on Elm Street, which I thought was better than the original.
Okay.
Which I know
that's pretty controversial.
Would not agree with me on that.
Yeah. But, only because I don't like the way they went with Freddy with his character. I personally don't like it. I like the original idea.
I liked that
they made him way too much child rapey.
I thought that's what made it a little bit better like make him kind of a... Well, he was always rapey. He was always a rapey character.
He was without them having to, like, walk you to it and show you it. You know what I mean?
I understand that.
Yeah.
I agree with you there.
And then Nightmare on Elm Street 2 is just a whole nother bag of fun.
We'll go over that.
I think we'll review that one first. I can't wait. Oh, for sure.
That's the only one I haven't seen.
2 is on the list. None of the others are on the list right now.
Right. We should probably put that on there sooner than later. I feel like back in the day, also, directors and producers had a bit more creative freedom to make the films they wanted to make without having executives get in the way and kind of jingle their hands around and ruin things. Just look at, no offense, DC fans, but most of the DC movies are terrible. Justice League was bad. Batman vs. Superman. Oh, such a great movie to not watch.
This is not that kind of a podcast. We're not going to go butcher my...
I would have to say Batman vs. Superman is a great horror movie. It terrifies me.
All right, let's get back on track. Back on track here with our fun facts and trivia.
Let's do it.
So, I did a terrible job of actually going and doing any more research than what I've already probably discussed. Right. Other than the one thing I know for sure that I read was Stevie's character was mimicking a famous disc jockey from the 60s whose name was Allison Steele. So that's really interesting to me. She was known as the Nightbird back in the 60s when she was a disc jockey. So that's who she was mimicking her sultry voice after, if you want to go Google that and get some more audio for you audiophiles out there.
Well, so John Carpenter actually chose to shoot this movie in an anamorphic widescreen Panavision. Okay. And he just decided to kind of give it a bigger feel to make it not look like a low-budget horror film. Which it... Was it? It felt like it could be.
I mean, it wasn't... I mean...
Wasn't a high budget.
Yeah, no, it was... So, $750 million was Halloween. This was $1 million, and then The Fog got $15 million.
Well, tell me what you're talking about, like, going back to the trivia. Mm-hmm. What are you talking about, Botton? You're talking about makeup specialist Rob Botton yesterday.
Yeah. So he... what was I talking about?
He was, like, 6 feet five, 6 foot five.
Oh, and, that's yeah. right. So, basically, Botton asked Carpenter if he could be... He wanted to be in the movie. So, Carpenter told him to stand up. So, Botton stands up in the room, and Botton thought he was going to say, "And now get out." But instead, he said, "You're going to be Blake." So Botton actually got to play Blake in the movie because he was 6 foot five and just a huge man. He was just a big dude. So they thought he would be the perfect guy to play Blake in the film, which is cool. Because remember, in a week, we're going to be talking about The Thing. And Botton was actually the makeup specialist at the age of 22 for that film, which means he was only 20 when he starred in this film.
Very well-known makeup specialist today. Very renowned. A lot of people actually, I think, is he the one that kind of made a school? Or
no, that's Savini.
That's Savini, okay.
My fave.
Right. So actually, there's one cool thing. So Father Malone, when he discovers the journal, it very briefly kind of shows one of the pages. And if you look at what it says, "My college education to work writing dumb shit and this fucking movie's props being one, it's time to bring the words guy to the big tits, tattoos, and shaved beavers. I know horny blank would go blank some of that."
Yeah.
That's pretty funny.
Yeah. So if you pause, I think if you pause the movie at the right moment, you can actually see the full-on page that you're talking about. Yeah.
They use jazz music for the radio station.
Yeah, because it's cheaper.
Exactly.
Than rock music. Yeah. I saw that one too. I was like, you know, that one, that it's good, but I don't, I mean.
We're stealing these from IMDb, by the way.
Oh, yeah. We're just totally ripping off IMDb.
We're parroting this off. So when we get sued for nothing, because this is all done for free. These are really cool things to look at, you know. Check out the trivia if you're interested.
And always read the reviews.
Kurt Russell was offered a role in this movie. That's one of the coolest things.
It's actually kind of, I mean...
If Kurt Russell was the main character in this film, it would not have been much better.
I can't see him in Tom Atkins' role, though.
I can.
As a fisherman?
I can, easily.
Okay.
Easily. He was a carpenter in Overboard with Goldie Hawn.
Yeah, but that was a comedy.
Yeah, but
I guess it would add more humor to this.
Is a comedy.
I mean, the fact that John Carpenter initially wanted it to be PG and not R is actually, that makes more sense with a Kurt Russell funnier version of Tom Atkins' character, maybe. I mean, there's no nudity in this movie. How did it get such an R rating?
Back in the 80s, like, it was very questionable, like, how they rated things. Like, there's a movie called My Bully or something like that that starred Rick Moranis and Tom Arnold, I think.
Okay.
And it was rated R, but there's no reason much to it for it.
And then you get freaking PG-13 movies that have full frontal nudity of old ladies.
Critters too.
Elves.
Elves.
How the fuck did we get a full frontal?
Old. She's still alive and she still looks the same.
Yeah, but she didn't look good. Remember we talked about that.
No, she's not attractive. Ugh. But it's all the 1980s. Whatever the stuff they were doing back then. I don't know.
Well, that's all we've got for fun facts and trivia.
That's all we got.
We're going to move on to coming soon for February. So the horror movie's being released in February. Remember, we do these usually the first episode of the month. The reason why we do this is just to give you as listeners a chance to kind of reach back out to us and let us know if there's anything you want us to go watch for you and report back on. So some of the movies coming out in February are in the horror aspect are Come to Daddy, which has Elijah Wood in it.
The Prodigy.
The Lodge. After Midnight. Fantasy Island. VFW.
I'm interested in Fantasy Island.
Okay. Brahms, The Boy 2, The Invisible Man.
Right.
And that's it. That's it for February from my perspective.
You can't forget Doolittle. That's a terrifying... Oh, that came out in January. You're right.
Good try, though, Sir Clark.
What about The Quiet Place 2? When is that coming out again?
That's not till later in the year, March. Yeah.
Testing you here.
I mean... Are we going to go see that?
You know what? We might.
Okay.
Might have to see the first one, too.
Well, what have you been up to lately? What have you watched, read, or listened to lately?
You know, I've been... I watched The Witcher on Netflix a while ago, and I've been rewatching through it. It's one of those series that they really want you to watch again just so you can make sense of which timeline you're in.
Okay.
They do not do a very good job of explaining this is in the past, this is in the past, this is in the present.
Have you read the books, comics, graphic novels, and or played the video game series?
I played the first two games. I have no interest in reading the books. I know that the show is based off the books. It's just I'd rather not read a book that was not written in my mother language that has been translated, especially if it's translated from Polish to English. No offense, I'm sure they're great books, but my understanding is they just jump right into it, and you have no idea of what's going on unless you read the short stories first. And even then, there's still a bit of confusion.
Interesting.
So I like a little bit of world building in my books. I like a little bit of things, and I'll watch the show.
Okay.
It's kind of my thing right now.
But I like it.
How about yourself?
So the wife and I have been watching a show. She loved it last season. I didn't think it was going to be like a big hit, but some of you have definitely heard of the show You on Netflix, starring Penn Badgley from Gossip Girl. And basically it follows this character, Joe, who's a bookstore owner, and it follows him through this creepy path of social stalking this young girl, Beck, and just kind of how he wins her over through stalking her and knowing more than she needs to know.
What?
Yeah, he's a total creep, and he basically,
I hate this already.
He knows so much about her that he can bend people, manipulate people, get rid of people by murdering them, and make her think that he's the hero. And then, you know, it still twisted me, even though I thought I knew how it was going to end. But season two just relaunched, so I had to finish season one because I hadn't finished it yet. We've done that now, and we'll be moving on to season two, and I'll give kind of an idea.
You got your wife to watch this?
She got me to watch it.
Really?
Yeah. So there's a couple of shows like that. Vampire Diaries. So I started watching that show first for the vampire aspect. She started watching it because I had it on, and she was looking over my shoulder, whatever, and fell in love with the romance options. And
obviously.
Then, yep. And then she ends up finishing it, and I didn't even end up finishing it.
No, I lost interest when I saw the first 5 minutes. So I don't blame you.
Yeah.
But
so, anyways, that's what I've been up to lately.
Nice.
Yeah.
Anyhow, let's jump into the plugs portion here.
Plugs
let's
away.
Talk about our email address first.
Okay.
For those of you who love to give us some feedback, who would love to maybe even guest star on our podcast and suggest a film to watch with us, please email us at
twoguysandsomehorror@gmail.com, fully written out.
And then for our Instagram and our Twitter, it's the number two.
Yes.
Guys Horror Pod.
Correct. So it is a little confusing. We do apologize. The show name's rather long, so.
We'll put this information. It'll be in the description.
Always.
Also, so please give us a check. Shout out to us. Look at our Instagram. Look at our Twitter. What movies do you want to watch? What movies do you like? What's your favorite horror movie? What's your least favorite horror movie?
So just want to give a cool shout out to another podcast that follows us and has shown us some love. They left us a really nice review on iTunes. They are Unwanted Things. You can follow them at things_unwanted. They are an anthology podcast about horror and unwanted things, which is really, really nifty. I've given a couple of their episodes a listen, and every time I listen to it, it blows my mind what people can come up with. But I just want to read their review real quick. So it's titled Hidden Gem. I love horror, but unfortunately don't have many friends that share that interest. So I love this show because it helps me feel like a part of a conversation about some great movies, maybe even opening my eyes to a new movie occasionally. We really appreciate that. Thank you for that review. And reviews are super helpful. Subscriptions are super helpful on like Spotify and other podcast sources. So if you want to see more of us and help us build a bigger following, make sure you leave that like, that follow, that subscribe, those retweets, whatever it may be, you know, come hang out with us.
Ring that bell. We're not on YouTube, but
ding that bell. We really do appreciate everything you guys do for us, and we have a lot of fun doing it. So, come share that fun and that happiness with us.
Yeah. Thank you for participating in this journey with us. This is a love project for Curtis and me, and we really like you having you along for the ride. So thank you.
Yeah. Thank you guys. See you later.
Thank you so much for listening to us. And as always, we'll be here next week. We love you guys. Hope to hear again. Hope you listen to us again. More Clark Gaffes. 2020 Clark Gaffes all the time.